Hi, good afternoon. My name is Rahul Pandita. I'm a journalist and an author, more recently of a book called Our Moon Has Blood Clots. It is essentially a memoir on growing up in Kashmir in the early 90s as a Hindu minority and the subsequent exodus of a small community in Kashmir called the Kashmiri Pandits that constituted about 5% of the Kashmir Valley's total population in 1990 and were hounded and brutalized out of their homes by Islamic extremists in the spring of 1990. The essential part of this book is the fact that for the last almost quarter of a century, there's been this one narrative which has come out of Kashmir Valley, in which the story of the Kashmiri Pandits was kept marginalized, it was kept out of that narrative. So my book, my memoir, Our Moon Has Blood Clots, is basically a very honest attempt to tell people, readers, the other side of the Kashmir story, which was left unrecorded and buried in these last 25 years. Well, it is part memoir and part reportage. So in the book I deal, this is a story of a 14-year-old boy, which is me. I was 14 in 1990 when all hell broke loose in Kashmir and we were forced out of our home. And the consequent subsequent suffering of our community in refugee camps in the Indian plains, in Jammu, in Delhi and elsewhere. So one portion of the book deals with that story, but there are other stories which I have also told of people not only in 1990, but what happened in the 80s as a build up to what resulted in 1990. It also deals with the circumstances right after India's independence, when Kashmir was still a princely state, and the tribesmen from Pakistan attacked Kashmir. And a number of people among Kashmiri Pandits had to suffer, and for the first time in 1947 they became refugees in their own state, which then later led to them becoming refugees in their own country when they had to move out of Kashmir Valley. So yes, it is part memoir, part reportage, which has been written with a very strict journalistic regimen, because I was very conscious of the fact that this book will have to pass through a lot of scrutiny, because there are people, especially in Kashmir Valley, who are still in an extreme state of denial as far as the circumstances that led to the exodus of Kashmiri Pandits is concerned. So they are still uncomfortable with the idea, with the questioning of truth, and that is what I wanted to do, because in the last few years what has happened is that I was really becoming angry about the way our story was left unspoken and nobody was really bothered to tell the story. So here was this, for the media largely, this story, the Kashmiri story, has remained a black and white story, where there's this one set of people who have been brutalized by the Indian state. But what the media and the writers forget or choose to ignore at times is that the same set of people have brutalized another set of people who happen to be Kashmiri Pandits in this case. So I thought, as a journalist, as someone who seeks truth from other corners of the world, especially from the Maoist corridor, where I have a certain position as far as the Maoist movement is concerned, and that position is not based out of my experience from Delhi, but from ground zero really. So I thought it is very imperative, not as a Kashmiri Pandit, but as a journalist, to tell this story, which incidentally deals with my own life and that of the other members of my community. No, I think in Kashmir's case what has happened is that the movement was led by these boys who crossed over the border to the line of control and went over to Pakistan, occupied Kashmir of Pakistan in many cases, and came back with arms, etc. And they were defined by a certain ideology, which is Islamist in nature. But what they've achieved in Kashmir Valley could not have been achieved without the support of a significant number of ordinary people, as it happens in any other conflict zone where there are minorities. If you look at Rwanda, for example, or Bosnia, or anywhere else really. The same, you know, similar things have happened. So that is what happened to us in Kashmir as Kashmiri Pandits as well, when our own neighbors and colleagues and friends who had spent decades with us, who had sort of, people who had grown up with my father or mother, they turned up against us all across the Kashmir Valley in 1990. So we have to say that. So it's not only about those handful of hundreds of young men who came back with the gun. They could not have done that without the support and understanding of a number of people who were really ordinary people who had no arms, but that were driven by that euphoria that existed in Kashmir Valley in 1990. I think it's a narrative. You know, it's technically a memoir and a reportage. You know, I talk about, like I said, how these things built up through the 80s, and how we sort of failed to see those signals. It's really ironic how we failed to see those signals because after migration, when I was in the process of writing this book, I spoke to so many people, and I was surprised that most of us have similar stories to tell. For example, when I was growing up, and we had this Muslim milkman coming to our house daily, and sometimes my father would be renovating the house, because the idea of home, it's a universal theme, but it holds specially true for a Kashmiri, irrespective of the fact whether he's a Muslim or a Hindu. So every time my father would have some savings and he would be renovating the house, and this milkman would come. And this is late 80s, 86, 87, the second part of 80s. And he would say why are you wasting your money on this house? Because today or tomorrow, sooner or later, this house will belong to us. And we would dismiss him because we took it as a joke. But later, of course, in 89-90, we realized that what he was saying was, he was just trying to convey some kind of message to us, and we failed to read those signals. And it is amazing when I spoke to so many people from my community, and they had similar stories to tell. But in this case, the character changed. So in our case, it was a milkman. In somebody else's case, it was a colleague. In somebody else's case, it was a carpenter. In somebody else's case, it was a driver who used to work for the family. But they all had this really menacing message to send across to the minority in Kashmir that, tomorrow this house will belong to us, and you'll have to leave, and you will be sent into an exile, which is almost becoming permanent exile now. Well, this essentially deals with the circumstances of 1990, and I also deal with the 1980s, and like I said, 1947. So I've just also given a brief history of what has been transpiring in Kashmir for many, many hundreds of years, for those who are not aware of the history of Kashmir, because there's Hindus, there's a large history of, long history of persecution of the Hindus in Kashmir Valley. So I briefly touched upon that, but that's for someone who does not know Kashmir. But it is specifically deals more or less with the events that led to our exodus in 1990. Yes. While I was researching this book and while I was writing this book, as a journalist, I've been going to Kashmir since 1998. My parents have, of course, never been there after 4th April 1990, that is the day when we left Kashmir. But I've been going off and on. I go there every 2-3 months as a journalist. But while I was specifically writing and researching this book, I went there many times, and some of the portions of the book deal with what is happening right now. For example, there have been a few hundred Kashmiri Pandits who were sent back under the Prime Minister's 2008 so-called rehabilitation package, where they got government jobs in Kashmir, and there are portions that deal with what happened to them after they went back, and how they were harassed by their Muslim colleagues in various government offices. The book also deals with what is happening to the Kashmiri refugees, Pandit refugees, in these settlements that have been created by the government in Jammu and elsewhere. Absolutely. I think personally, in our case, the bigger denial for us, the bigger tragedy for us is the denial of these circumstances. Because like I said, you know, there are many people in Kashmir who are still in a denial mode about what happened to Kashmiri Pandits in 1990. The situation has normalized more or less. Of course, there's this huge, significant population of youngsters who have got more radicalized than ever. But the militancy is more or less over, and I think now is the time to start some kind of truth and reconciliation, which, you know, as it has happened in other countries or places that have had similar experiences with the minority community. But I'm afraid, and I'm very certain that truth and reconciliation is not going to be possible unless there is a complete consensus on the circumstances that led to the exodus of Kashmiri Pandits. But that, unfortunately, is not happening as we speak, because, like I said, they are in extreme denial about what happened in 1990.